Got it?
Yes, sir.
Simple.
Yes.
Now, which means using objects, you can access the variables. Using objects, you can access the methods also. A class is nothing but a structure or a template that has data members, which are nothing but data variables and data methods. Both can be accessed by using the objects of a class and object name dot member name. And these objects can be created only inside main method, because main method is declared as the starting point for the program execution. Do you understand these basics?
Yes, sir.
Very simple. Java is very, very, very easy language, very simple language. Not all people know the secret. Many people, they get scared because, okay, rather than believing ourselves, we always depend on others. We always depend on, see, instead of watching the movie directly, we will always ask other friends, how was the movie? How was the review? If he said that he didn't like that movie, the movie was bakwas, you people stop seeing that movie itself. We should always have our own opinion about everything, right? Because once we watch the movie, we will come to know we may like the movie. He didn't like the movie because his taste is different. We will like the movie because it's all our efforts, right? Even some people may find difficulty with Java because they may not understand this. They may not have tried understanding Java in a proper way. We like Java very much because we understanding the topics in Java in a proper way. And we keep the things. We load, for example, from the basics, we are trying to inject the knowledge of Java into our minds proper way, step by step, one after another. We are just injecting this information into our mind in a constructed manner. Slowly, we are gaining confidence on programming in Java. Slowly, we are learning the concepts in Java. Once we have understanding towards a programming language, tomorrow you will definitely try to write the code by yourself. It will take some time. First, we should understand the basics. Okay, so far, is this clear?
On the guy who is handling that particular language.
Not like that. Also, depends on the associates. Their interest also should be there.
How far they are interested. So, what the thing?
Good.
Really, very good presentation, sir. Very, very easy, simple examples to make each and everyone understandable.
Sure. We'll go through the most of the topics in Core Java. And all these topics also, we will go with a sample example. You just have to spend some time with me. Probably for another 2 hours, we'll complete the Core Java completely. 2 hours is more than enough. For me, Core Java, to teach Core Java, 3 hours is more than enough. Along with the hands-on, I will teach you. And this Java knowledge is much more enough for us to do map-reducing coding in Hadoop. Okay? So now it is 10:55. Mostly by 1 o'clock we'll close this Core Java, and in the afternoon session we'll take a break for lunch hour for 1 hour, and then afternoon session I'll be take session for 1.5 hour or 2 hours. In that session I'll teach you the map reduce concept.
Okay.
Tomorrow we'll go with map reduce coding, map reduce programming, and some POC demonstration.
Okay sir.
Okay, now So at 11:30, probably after another half an hour, I'll give you a break for 5 minutes or 10 minutes. So we'll close some more topics and then we'll go for a break.
Yeah.
Anyone is overloaded with the information? Can we move further?
Yes. Simply enjoying what are all things that you are saying.
Method overloading. That's it.
Method overloading. Because same methods with multiple... method name is same, but arguments and the type of arguments is different. And using method of overloading concepts only, we have something called as polymorphism. I'll tell you that slowly. Okay. Now, let's get into some topic called as access specifiers. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Access specifiers, we have majorly 3 access specifiers in Java. One is public, protected, and private. So what is this public, what is this private and protected? Public is an access specifier. See, it's the name itself says that access specifier. It specifies the access scope of a member of a class, maybe a variable or a method. Okay, so for example, if I give a variable, see generally what happens if I have a package A, then I have another package B. Okay, now not A, I'll give the package name as some P1 and the package name as P2. I have two packages, ma. Okay, in package A, package one, I have a class A. I have another class B, I have class C, and I have another class D. In package 2, I have a class called as E, and I have class F, and I have in package 2, I have class G, and I have another class called as H. Okay, now assume that class B is the child class of A. Okay, similarly, class F is also the child class of E class. Okay, now, for example, if class A is public. The members of class A is public. What does it mean? Can I use a public toilet? Is it restricted to any particular person?
No, we can use.
Right? So if the members of a class A is public, is declared as public, how can I declare it as public? You can see here, this method add is declared as public. I can use protected keyword also. I can use private keyword also. If I say public, which means this add method can be called from anyone. Now I'm calling add method by the same class object. I can also call this add method from the child class member B. I can also call this member from the C class, D class, which means other classes. They are not child classes, but they are other classes of the same package. I can also call the public members from other package members also. Isn't it? If a foreigner comes to India, to Chennai, I have a public toilet, actually, will it be used only by local people?
No, no.
The other country people can also use it. Right? Public means it's open to all. So, same class members, child members, other non-child members in the same package, other package members can also access the public members. Okay. If I have declared it as protected, which means the members which is declared as protected can be accessed only within the package.
Okay, sir.
Only that class members, child class members, and non-child class members of the same package can be accessed. So if class A is protected, can it be accessed by class E? No, because E class is from the different package. Okay? Just like a gated community. You have a gated community. And you have inside gated community, I have a club. I have a swimming pool and gym. In that gated community, I have 150 apartments. All the 150 apartment people can use the gym and swimming pool?
Yes, sir. They can make use.
It's protected. It's so which, but can it be used by the outside people?
No.
So it is within the package. Now, let's take it about a private. Now, I have a particular same swimming pool I have constructed in my own flat. Okay, let's assume that it's a bathroom. I have a personal bathroom in my house, in my flat. Can all the gated community people can use my bathroom?
No.
No, definitely no, because that is private. Private means the members of, if they are declared as private, it can be accessed only within the class, within inside the class. Even child class members cannot access them. You understand? So they are within the class. Okay. So private within the class, protected within the package, and public anywhere. It defines the scope of the particular data members of the class. Access specifiers. That's what it says. Okay. It specifies the accessing scope. Is it clear? So that's why before we declare variables, sometimes I'll say like this, protected int A. Before I declare the variable, I can use these keywords. If I have not used anything, by default, they are public.
Okay.
Okay. So before the method declaration or variable declaration, I'll be using the access specifier because it specifies the access scope for the corresponding members of the class.
Okay.
Now, why we have something called as string array? I know what is meant by string, but what is this open and closed square braces? What is this open and closed square braces? What does that mean? It says that it is an array. What is an array? Array is nothing but collection of elements of the same data type. For example, so if I have arrays, I have int A. Now A can hold only one value called as 10. But if I want to take int A of, what does it mean? It is an array, which means it can take some collection of elements, some set of elements, 30, 40, 50. So for example, I'm taking 5 elements. All these 5 data elements can be represented by only one variable called as A. Okay, with a single variable, I can represent multiple values also, but all these multiple values should be of same data type of integer. So this is array is said to be called as homogeneous collection of elements. Homogeneous means same data type. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Right. So how can I access if I want only, you see, for example, if object name dot A, I will get value 10. But if I want to access the array values, how can I do object name dot A of 0? 0 is nothing but the starting index of the array. Now 20 is at the index 1. 30 is at index 2, 40 is at index 3. So array index, elements index starts from 0 to n minus 1, where n is the number of elements in the array. And you can access the element using the A of, give the corresponding index. Whatever may be the value is there in that index, that value will be retrieved. Okay. Now, main method, by default, they have given syntax like, main method should have a variable called some A variable, some args variable. This variable data type should be always an array of strings. They have declared like this. Why? Because they have given some syntax. Because we have something called as command line arguments. What is meant by command line arguments? Command line arguments means when I am running my program, so I can pass the arguments to the main method from my command prompt. I can do that. So if I want to pass any arguments from the command prompt, I can do that using, and then those arguments, see, if I am passing 10, 20, I am passing those values as a to the method. So this 10, 20 is taken by example constructor. Even to the main method, you can pass some arguments. From where I can pass? From the command prompt I can pass. How can I pass from the command prompt? So if you just go here, on the top, you have some arrow mark beside this green color button. If you go for run configurations, you have something called as arguments. Yes, I can pass the arguments like 10. Okay.
Yeah.
20. Okay, I can just give two values. Apply. Okay. Now I have given those two values. What should I do? Instead of A, what I will do now? I have given two values directly in the arguments. Arguments directly will be copied where? See, now, if I am giving 10 and 20, these 10 and 20 will be copied in P and Q. Yeah. If I want to pass arguments to the main method, these arguments can be passed through command line arguments. I have given 10 and 20 there. So that will be copied automatically into this array. How can I get that? Args of 0. If I say 0, what does it mean? What is the 0th element I am passing?
First number.
10.
First number is
correct.
Yeah.
And args of 1. What does it mean?
The second number 20.
So here there is a chance, but these arguments are there in which data type?
String.
String. What data type I am passing?
Integer.
So A and B is integers. So I should convert that. To convert that, for every primitive data type, there is a predefined class. For integer data type, their integer class is there. Eclipse is very good because if you say class name dot, when you say dot, whatever the methods that is available in that class will be shown automatically. So there is a method called as parse int, which says that even though you pass other data type elements, it will be converted into integer format.
Okay.
So I am passing arguments of zero. What is the arguments of zero? It has a value 10, which is represented in string format. From command line arguments, yeah, anything you pass will be considered as a string argument.
Okay,
from command line arguments, anything you pass will be considered as a string argument. That's why that string, I want to copy into a variable A, but A is an integer. I want to do conversion of string to integer. How can I do that? Using integer.parseInt method. Okay. Now, similarly, I will do it here. I'm converting this string also into okay.
Yeah.
Now let me run this program and then see the output. Got it?
Yes.
So you can access the arguments data from the command prompt, which means these values will be taken from the runtime. You can take it, but those arguments will be stored automatically in your main method string array args. Whatever the data that you submit, though if I pass not only 10 and 20, if I pass 2.5, 4.6, if I pass characters, if I pass double values, anything you pass from the command line arguments will be taken as strings only. And that strings have to be converted into your required data format. Okay. And you can, after conversion, you can use them. Okay.
Yeah.
Now you can ask me why actually everything is, though I give 10 and 20 in the arguments, how it is getting represented as strings? Does anyone got that doubt? Because if you see in my arguments, I'm passing 10 and 20. They are integers.
Yeah.
But they are copied into string variables, which means that integers are converting into strings.
Yeah.
Who is doing that conversion? Why that is happening? By default, for all the classes that we write, the parent class is object class. Okay, one second.
Okay.
1 second.
வெளியில இருந்து பண்ண ஜாவா சி கம்பேர் பண்றீங்க. ஜாவா சி ஜாவா ப்ரோக்ராம்னு இருந்துருக்கீங்களா பக்கத்துல ஆரம்பி Sir, are you talking, sir? Srikant, sir?
Ah, brush chair, sir.
సార్ ఎలా రావా
ఇప్పుడు మామూలుగా ఫస్ట్ మనం క్లాస్ క్రియేట్ చేసుకున్న తర్వాత ఇక్కడ పబ్లిక్ అని చెప్పి ఇంటిజర్ ఏ వాల్యూ బి వాల్యూ ఇచ్చేసి ఈ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ రాయకుండా నార్మల్ ఐ మీన్ ఈ రెండు స్కిప్ చేసిన ఇక్కడికి వెళ్ళిపోతాం. సో యాడ్ యాక్షన్ తీసుకుంటున్నాం.
యాడ్ యాక్షన్ జరగదు ఎప్పుడు, ఇలా ఏం ఎగ్జిక్యూట్ అవ్వదు.
అంటే ఒకసారి ఫస్ట్ ఏ వాల్యూ తీసుకున్నాం బి వాల్యూ తీసుకున్నాం క్రియేట్ చేస్తాం, ఏకి అసైన్ చేస్తాం బికి అసైన్ చేస్తాం. సో నెక్స్ట్ ఏంటంటే మనం యాడ్ ఫంక్షన్ అనేది
చేయాలనుకుంటున్నాం,
యాడ్ ఫంక్షన్ చేయాలనుకుంటున్నాం కాబట్టి సో ఇది రాసుకున్నాం యాడ్ ఏ ఇంట్ సి ఈక్వల్ టు ఏ ప్లస్ బి. సో సిస్టమ్ ప్రింట్అవుట్ డాట్ ఎల్. ఇక్కడికి వచ్చేటప్పటికి మనం క్లాస్ని కాల్ చేసుకున్నాం. ఇది కాల్ చేసుకున్న తర్వాత ఫస్ట్ క్లాస్ కాదు వస్తుంది, క్లాస్ క్లాస్ తర్వాత ఇది వస్తుంది. సో ఈ డాట్ యాడ్ అనగానే యాడ్ కాల్ అవుతుంది కదా. అప్పుడు ఏ వాల్యూ అసైన్ అయిన దానికి ఏ ఆల్రెడీ ఇనిషియల్గా ఏ వాల్యూ అసైన్ చేస్తుంది. సో ఏ ప్లస్ బి ఈక్వల్ టు సి వాల్యూ ఇక్కడ ప్రింట్ అవుతుంది. ఇప్పుడు అలా కాకుండా స్టార్టింగ్ ఇక్కడ మనం ఏ వాల్యూ ఇవ్వాలి, ఇంటిజర్ వాల్యూ వల్ల బి వాల్యూ అసైన్ చేసుకోవాలి. సో ఇక్కడ అసైన్ చేసుకున్నాం ఎగ్జాంపుల్ అనేది, అంటే క్లాస్లో ఏ వాల్యూ ఇచ్చాం బి వాల్యూ ఇచ్చాం. సో రాగానే ఇక్కడ మనకి ఏమవుతుంది నెక్స్ట్ స్టెప్లో, అంటే ఫస్ట్ ఇది కాల్ చేసుకుంటుంది ఎగ్జాంపుల్ కాల్ చేసుకొని దాని తర్వాత ఈ డాట్ యాడ్, అంటే ఈ ఆల్రెడీ మనం ఎగ్జాంపుల్ అసైన్ చేసాం. సో ఈలో ఎగ్జాంపుల్లో ఏ వాల్యూ ఉంది బి వాల్యూ ఉంది అది కాల్ చేసుకున్న తర్వాత ఇక్కడ యాడ్ ఫంక్షన్ పెర్ఫామ్ చేస్తుంది అంతే కదా. అంటే మనం ఎన్ని
విధాలుగా
అవును ఏంటంటే కమాండ్ ప్రాంప్ట్ లోకి వెళ్ళిపోయి
యూజువల్లీ కన్స్ట్రక్టర్ యూస్ చేయగల మామూలు మెథడ్ లో కూడా వాల్యూ అసైన్ చేయొచ్చు, దానిలో ఏ వాల్యూ బి వాల్యూ ఏంటని అసైన్ చేయొచ్చు.
సో ఇది వచ్చేటప్పటికి కన్స్ట్రక్ట్ మెథడ్ ఈ పర్టికులర్ లైన్,
ఏ పర్టికులర్ లైన్
ఇది
ఇదంతా కన్స్ట్రక్టర్ కాదు.
అంటే ఇప్పుడు మనం కన్వర్ట్ చేసాం కదా,
ఇదే కన్స్ట్రక్టర్. కన్స్ట్రక్టర్ ఇస్ ఎ మెథడ్ విత్ ద సేమ్ నేమ్ విత్ నో డేటా టైప్. కన్స్ట్రక్టర్ మెథడ్ నేమ్ చూసాం అనుకో ఎగ్జాంపుల్ అనే ఉంటుంది, ఎగ్జాంపుల్ అనే మెథడ్ టైప్ పబ్లిక్ ఉండదు, వాయిడ్ ఉండదు, రిటర్న్ టైప్ ఉండదు, ఏ ఉండదు. ఇది డిఫాల్ట్ కండక్టర్, ఇది కన్స్ట్రక్టర్, ఇది పారామీటరైజ్ కన్స్ట్రక్టర్.
Sorry guys, I got a call from my home, that's why. So shall we start back? Hello? Guys, can you hear me? Hello? హలో,
ఎస్ సార్, శ్రీకాంత్ సార్, ఐ యామ్ హియర్.
సారీ, ఐ గాట్ ఎ కాల్ ఫ్రమ్ మై హోమ్, దట్స్ వై. యు కెన్ హియర్ మీ రైట్? సో వి హావ్ సీన్ ది కన్స్ట్రక్టర్స్ అండ్ వి హావ్ సీన్ ది కమాండ్ లైన్ ఆర్గ్యుమెంట్స్ యాస్ వెల్ రైట్? సో నౌ వి విల్ స్టార్ట్ విత్ ఆబ్జెక్ట్ ఓరియెంటెడ్ ప్రోగ్రామింగ్ ఫీచర్స్. Okay,
we have yet to discuss why it is a string.
Correct. I have a short term memory loss, please bear with me. We were discussing about that why it is string, right? See, the parent class for all any program what we write, okay, for them the default parent class is object class. Okay, yeah. And inside the object class, there is a method called as a toString method.
Okay.
So this method automatically converts any input argument to your main method into string. That is the reason.
Okay.
Is internal Java behavior. Okay. So what the thing you have to remember is, what is the default parent class for every Java class is object class.
Object.
Okay. And default parent package for every Java program is java.lang package.
Okay, sir.
So for example, in Java, if I want to display today's date, Java is a rich set of APIs. Okay. Java is a very rich set of APIs. API means application programming and interface, which means some collection of classes and interfaces. So close to 1.5 lakh methods and classes are there in core Java itself.
Wow.
So more than 1.5 lakhs of classes and interfaces, and around 13 lakh methods are there, 1-3.
Yeah.
So is it possible for us to remember all those classes and interfaces? It's not possible.
Definitely, yeah.
So for example, they have categorized each package as depending on their types. For example, all language related classes and all, they kept it inside a package called the java.lang. All network related classes and interfaces, they have kept inside net package. All IO related, like input and output related, they kept it under IO package. Graphical user interface related, they kept it in AWT package. Okay. So like that, they have categorized the classes and interfaces.
Okay.
So what we should do is, now this package, we can't remember all those classes, so we will go for Java documentation. For example, let me open it here. So I'll say java.doc. If you go open Java documentation, see, you have all packages on your left hand side on the top. You have AWT package, IO package, lang package. Inside lang package, what and all classes are there? When you click on lang package, here the interfaces and classes in that package will be displayed. So there is a class called as object class, right? When you click on that class, on your right hand side, you will get the description about that class. And inside that class, what are the methods available? Inside that method, see, there is a method called as toString. Returns the string representation of the object. Got it?
Okay.
For example, why they have given all these classes and interfaces? Because they are rich set of API. Because of these existing classes, existing methods, I no need to write the code again for the same functionality. I can use the existing code itself. Java is very simple because Java provides us the rich set of APIs. For example, if I want to display today's date, what will I do? In C language, I have to write the code, 7 to 8 lines of code I should write. But in Java, that is very simple task, because in util package, there is a package named util package, and there is a class called as date class. See here, there is a class called as date. When I click on date class, inside date class, there is a method called as getDate method. Get month, get time. There is a method called as getDate. Can you see this? This method gives the description, like this returns the day of the month. So if I have this method already available, why should I write my code? Not necessary. Now you got a doubt, like how can I use these existing methods in my program? So to use the existing methods, what should I do is, first I should import that package in my program. Now which package I want to import? Java.util package. When I say dot means inside, star means all. So I'm going to import all. Import is a keyword used to import all the classes in util package into my program. Now, inside this class, I'm going to use a method. Which method I want to use? GetDate method. GetDate, any method can be accessed only using objects. So I should create the object for date class. So date, the class name is, some object name is equal to new constructor, right? Is this the way how to create the object for the class? Yes. Object name dot get date. Now I want to display today's date on the screen. System dot out dot println. In the output itself, I'm going to display this date. D dot get date. It will return the date. And that one I'm displaying in the output. So that's why I kept it inside println statement.
Okay.
So right click on this program. Today is 16th. Is it right?
Yes.
Correct? So it got displayed. So did I return any code here to display today's date?
No.
I just used. I've just used existing APIs. I've imported the existing package and declared an object for the class that what I want, and using that object I have just invoked the methods what is already available.
Yeah.
Right, so
yes sir,
one second. Fine, so what is that? So we have gone through, so for example, now you have another question in your mind. Okay Srikanth, you know Java and you come to know that yes, I have a date class in util package, and how do you come to know?
Yeah.
So tomorrow you might have seen Rajnikanth movie Shivaji. In the climax he will be opening the laptop. To open the laptop, he will be using speech recognition technology, correct? He will say, Shivaji, cool the boss. Then automatically the laptop will get, you know, recognize these words and then it will open, correct?
Yeah.
If I ask you, could you please develop a speech recognition application in Java? So will you write the code from scratch? You don't need to do that. You can use any of the functionalities that what you want to use, you want to implement, might be already defined in Java. You just have to use them. Only certain functionalities, see, only two things are possible. First thing is, if the functionality what you are expecting is already there, use it. If it is not there, you have to write your logic.
Okay.
And the third possibility is also there. If the functionality is already there, but you are not completely satisfied with the existing functionality, you just have to modify it a bit and then write your own code.
Okay.
Correct? So these three possibilities are there. Yeah. Blindly, I want to use the existing functionality, write my own functionality, or I can use the existing functionality with small changes that I can edit it and then I can use it.
Yeah.
So these three functionalities I can do. So for that, what I will do, so you can, when we don't know which API it belongs to, which package it belongs to, which class it belongs to, so what should I do? Always we people are said to be called as gods. Correct? All of you, including myself, okay, all of we people belongs to, we are called as God, Google-oriented developer.
Yes. Correct?
Simple. So we will go to Google. I'll ask it, speech recognition application in Java. Now it gave me a package called as Java Speech API. Yes, I came to know the API name. Java Speech API documentation. Again, Google it. Yes, I got it. I'll go here. Yes, I have a package called as JavaX.speech. Very good. Inside that package, there are another classes. Oh, there are many classes here. Speech event, speech permission, audio exception. Okay. For example, if I want a speech event, what does it mean? What does this class will do? Just go through some enough information about it. Inside that, I have many methods. Yes, is there any method that can help me? If not this package, okay, let's go for speech recognition. Okay, there is something called as recognizer interface. Inside this, what does, see, recognizer provides access to speech recognition capabilities. Yeah. So inside this, is there any method that can help me out? So scroll down. Yes, there are a lot of methods available. So here, you may find any method, get speaker manager. Get the rules and grammar. Using some of these methods, the syntax and all, you can find, identify the method which is suitable for your requirement and you can use them in your program. Just by using Googling, you can identify the API name. If you know the API name, you have the Java documentation already available. If you have the documentation, you'll come to know what method you have to use. And use the method, just, and then you can close your functionality. You can close your coding. If you know the Java basics, if you know how to Google for your requirement, based on your requirement, enough. You are a very good Java programmer, believe me.
Okay?
Good. Because that's why Java is said to be called as 70% component-based, 30% custom-based. Because the component-based means existing APIs are already there. 30% custom-based, only we will write, we have to know how to use them and how to proceed further.
Okay.
Good. Now, let's go to object-oriented programming features. we have actually Java features are there. Many people will say there are many Java features are there. Java is simple, Java is secured, Java is portable, Java is object oriented. Java is robust. Java is multi-threaded. Java is architecturally neutral. Java is interoperable. Java is distributed. Java is high performance. And Java is dynamic.
Yeah.
Okay, let's see. Java is simple. Is it simple to understand the syntax wise?
Yes, sir.
Every program starts with a class keyword and a body starts with flower brace and closes with flower brace. Method declaration starts with, no, again the same, some keyword with open and closed parenthesis and a body of the method. Is it simple to understand?
Yes. Yes, good.
So every program what you write, for example, if I have written an example program, that program have to be saved with the Java extension. How can I compile my program using a keyword called as Java C? Since you are executing in Eclipse, you are not actually typing these commands, but when you run this program using command line prompt, you just generally have to compile this program like this. Java C means Java compiler and give program name. What happens is this program automatically gets converted into example.class. Example.java program will be converted into example.class. So this class has only the, for example, see, now my if you see this program, when I compile my program, it will give me a .class code. That .class file contains some binary code, which bytecode actually, that cannot be understandable directly by us. It can be understandable only by the machines.
Okay.
So all these existing APIs, these Java people, they developed those 150,000 classes and interfaces. They provide us only the .class files. They don't give us the source code.
Okay.
Because if they give the source code to us, we will modify it and then we will misuse it, right?
Yeah.
More than that, there will be no standardization for the technology. So to leverage it, to standardize the existing classes, they have defined the code and they are just given the .class files to us. So using these .class files, you could able to run the program and see the output, but you cannot change the program again.
Yeah.
So now to run my program, I'll say Java keyword space, I'll just give example. No need to give .class because by default it is a Java command can run only class files.
Okay, okay.
So these existing APIs are .class files only. They won't give the source code to us because we cannot modify the original source code. Java is secured because they will share only .class files to us. You have a provision. You can write the project. You can build the project. And finally, you can generate the .class files. You can share the .class files to your friend. You can ask him to use the project code. Project application. He can run the output and he can see the output. But he cannot see the code because your Java programming is secured through the concept of .class files. Class files contains bytecode, which can be understandable only by your machine hardware. It can run the program, but cannot open the code. In this way, Java is secure. And once you compile the program, you can give the program to your friend. Your friend can carry the program to anywhere. He can carry the program to UK and then he can execute there. Won't it get executed? And is it simple to carry? Executed. Easy to carry? Is it so weight actually too much weight to carry?
No.
No, right? It's a simple program. So class files are portable, easy to carry anywhere.
Yeah.
Java is object oriented because every program, though you have data members, you cannot access those members without objects.
Yeah.
I have variable A, variable B, variable add method. You have everything in the class, but can you access them?
No, we need objects.
You need objects. So these objects possess certain features. They are object-oriented programming features. So those programming features are nothing but, okay, they are encapsulation. I'll tell you what is encapsulation: inheritance, polymorphism, and abstraction. I'll tell you these features, okay? Slowly, I'll tell you one by one. Encapsulation, inheritance, polymorphism, and abstraction. Right. So these features I'll explain you. Okay. Robust. What does it robust mean is, like, for example, if I'm executing my program and somewhere if I got user have entered a wrong input, and yeah, if it displays an error which user can't understand, do you think it's meaningful?
Yeah.
No. In a bank, it will ask you, please enter account number. You entered your name. They immediately should give you an message, right? Please enter your account number properly.
Yeah.
Instead of that, if it gives you, see, earlier programming language, they blindly give you some message, some error warning, some error messages, which user cannot understand, a programmer can understand.
Yeah.
So, but Java, you don't have that problem because Java is robust. You can handle the these kind of scenarios by using exception handling topic. You know which block of code is going to throw an error, throw an exception to the user. So when such instructions comes, what is the precaution measures that you should take? What exception message that you should display to the user? You can handle such kind of scenarios using exception handling. I'll tell you how to handle exceptions now.
Okay.
And multi-threaded, you can execute multiple programs parallelly. Yeah. Java in UK, Java in India is different. Everything is same, architecturally neutral. Interoperable. Okay. You can develop one business application and you can develop another web application or enterprise application. Both applications can handshake each other. Okay. Say I'm APSRTC is there. I can IRCTC is there. Okay, I can book the train ticket. At the end, and you have something like payment gateway and you have banking application. Banking application and IRCTC application both are integrated to provide a service to the user, right?
Yeah.
So such kind of applications you can do. You can integrate your Java application with other applications. Interoperability. Yes, Java supports distributed architecture because multiple programs can run in multiple machines parallelly in a network.
Yeah.
When multiple programs are running parallelly, obviously it is said to be called as it is giving you high performance.
Yeah.
Okay. And you have something called as dynamic. Because dynamically, it can accept the user inputs and it can process your code accordingly. I'll tell you like how dynamically you can accept the inputs from the user. I'll just see, there is a package called as IO package. Let me take that package. Import java.io.star. In this package, I have some predefined classes. Actually, yeah, to read input from the user, I'm not going to use to comment this code. I can just give this line. \ says that commenting, yeah, that line. What I will do now is,
yeah,
I have a class called as, I have a method called as read line. For example, e dot a is equal to integer dot parse int of, which means I'm going to convert string into integer. So there is a method called as read line. See, this method, which is used to read a line of input from the user from the command prompt. But this read line method is there in a class called as buffer reader. So what should I do? I will create a buffer reader class. Buffer reader br some object is equal to new buffered reader. But this class objects an argument. This constructor accepts an argument of input stream reader class. That's why I should create another class object called as input stream reader. This is the syntax actually. They gave it like that. Input stream reader is equal to new input stream reader which accepts the input from the system input device. That is nothing but my keyboard, right? From keyboard only user is going to give the inputs. So input stream reader, some IS is equal to new input stream reader. This IS, I'm going to pass it as an argument to buffer reader. Inside buffer reader object, now I have a method called as readline. So what is this? Okay, something class name is.
Can you please explain, sir, again?
Yes.
A little bit.
Now, I'll tell you. Now it is asking. Okay, I'll show you this error. See, to read the input from the user from the keyboard dynamically at the runtime, I have a method called as readline or readInteger. Some methods are available in a class called as buffered reader.
Okay.
This buffered reader accepts by default an argument of input stream reader class.
Okay.
So that's why I have declared input stream reader class. Its syntax looks like this. Yeah. So I'm reading input from the system input device.
Okay.
That object I am passing as an argument to your buffered reader. This is also syntax to create the buffered reader class object.
So we can't directly make the system directly in buffer.
No, we cannot give. Whenever you want to accept input from the keyboard, you have to use this input stream reader or buffer reader class. This is the way that how they defined the rules in Java. Otherwise, you have another way using the scanner class object. That is another way. This is one way. Okay. Now, inside buffer reader, I have a method called as readline method. See, this readline method can read the line of input data from user. Can I use the method name directly? No, I should use it using objects. This method is there in which class? Buffered reader, which is dependent on input stream reader. So whenever I use readline method, I have to write these three lines.
Yeah.
Okay. Sometimes coding in Java is more, but it is meaningful.
Yeah.
Okay. Now I have taken this readline. Now it is asking what happens if user have not given any input and how long I should wait?
Yeah.
So it may throw, which is nothing but exceptional case.
Yeah.
So such cases, it is asking me, see, in Eclipse, you get an error. You can see this error, red color icon. When you click on that, now it says that add, you can use a throws declaration or you can surround this statement with a try catch block.
Yeah.
If I use surround the statement with a try catch block, just see what happens. This particular line alone, the line which has an ability to throw the exception or error at the runtime is surrounded in a block called as try block.
Okay.
Set of instructions that has ability to throw an error at runtime, those instructions have to be placed inside try block. This is what it is called as exception handling in Java. That is why Java is robust. And when an exception is raised, for every kind of mistake the user do, the corresponding exception class object will be thrown automatically. If someone is throwing a ball, someone should be there to catch it. That's why following to try block, you have someone to catch that. So you have a catch block. Inside that catch block, you will specify the class name. There are a lot of exceptions are there. Each and every exception class says that the type of mistake the user is going to do.
Yeah.
Okay, user can do. Okay. So if user exception, whatever if he do, if for example, if he enters an input like 10, instead of 10, I can give 10F. It's a number format exception, right?
Yeah.
One second. Hello. So if, for example, if user gives an input like 10, instead of giving 10, if he gives input like 10F or 10A, is it correct? So that's wrong, right?
No.
So obviously it is a number format exception. Then obviously this catch block will be called. So inside this catch block, I can write my own code. See, inside this block, I'll write my own code. I'll say to the user,
enter integer values.
Please enter only integer value. See, if I write that such kind of meaningful messages inside catch block, when the error comes, okay, this catch block will be called. And yeah, the only that message will be displayed to the user. So user can understand it. So for example, you can ask me, yeah, I'm not sure which error user will do. He may do number format exception. He may do IO exception. He may do like, okay, null pointer exception, which means like he have not given any value, null value he can give. He can give only blank space.
Okay.
So for every mistake he do, there are different type of exception classes are there. So can we remember all those exceptions? Not necessary. What we will do, yeah, instead of writing that many number of catch blocks for every exception, I won't write multiple catch blocks. I can write, okay, for all exceptions, the parent class is exception class. So if my try block throw any kind of exception,
yeah,
it is the child class to exception class. So automatically this catch block will be called, and inside that the corresponding code will be executed.
Okay.
Simple. Exception handling is very simple. Yeah. You should write those, yeah, instructions which has an ability to throw an error at runtime inside try block. And that exception, oh, catch it using catch block. Inside catch block, what the message you want to display to the user, write it inside catch block.
Yeah.
Okay. And that exception class type, you should pass it as an argument to catch block.
Yeah.
Where exception class is the parent class. If you are not using try block, try catch block, you can also do it in another way. Like you can go to, see, this code is written inside main method, right? So
yeah,
at the end of the main method declaration, just give throws exception. So what does it mean? This method has a lot of code that has an ability to throw an exception. So I am telling to Java compiler, this code has an ability to throw the exception. So you understand?
Yes.
Yes. So two ways. One is using try catch block, or I can give this declaration by which my Java compiler can come to understand. Yes. You can run this code. Yes, this code has an ability to throw the error, but still not a problem. My Java compiler can compile it. Okay. So this is the way that how we can handle the exceptions. Got it. Now,
is it mandatory? So if you use try catch block, that we need to give throw exception in the main.
Correct. So if I write this code inside add method, then I, yeah, can give the throws declaration here. Throws keyword is used to specify to the Java compiler, yes, I am going to throw some kind of exception. If I am going to use, okay, the try catch block already, I no need to use throws keyword.
Sir, if you use throws, what sort of error message will be displayed? Sir, if you simply use a throws exception without using try catch insert, what sort of error message?
Meaningful messages won't get displayed. It will display Java error only. That message anyway user can't understand. Okay. That's why always we suggest you to use the try catch.
Try catch, okay. In order to make user friendlier.
Correct. శ్రీకాళహస్తికి దర్శనానికి వెళ్ళారు. శ్రీకాళహస్తికి అనువ దర్శనానికి వెళ్ళారు. క్యూ ఎక్కువగా ఉంది. స్టేషన్ ఆయన ఉన్నారు. ఒక నిమిషం ఉండండి, ఆయన నెంబర్ తీసుకొని ఇస్తాను. ఆయన అయితే డైరెక్ట్గా క్యూ లేకుండా మేము విఐపి దర్శనం తీసుకుంటే 2 నిమిషాలు తీసుకొచ్చేస్తారని చెప్పాను. ఆయన నెంబర్ పట్టుకోవడం, ఆయన ఉండాల్సిన హైదరాబాద్లో ఉన్నారు, ఆయన వేరే వాళ్ళ నెంబర్ పట్టుకోవడం, ఈ లోపల ఏమంటే మా వాళ్ళకి ఓపిక తక్కువ, మా బంగారు పెళ్ళి. I can dust on it. Good. Fine. We'll go for object-oriented programming. We'll have a 5 minutes break. Okay. Once we come back, we will see object-oriented programming futures. Once that concept is done, then what else we have? We have some simple keywords. Like, okay, we just left with the oops. Once oops is done, we'll go with the final keyword. We'll go with the static keyword. Okay. Got it?
And once that is done, I think then we are ready to kickstart our probably another 45 minutes or 1 hour session is there for Core Java. Because once that is done, I think we are ready to go with map reducing content. And so far, you anyone having any questions or any queries, any confusion, or you need any revision of any topic? I know you are listening it for the first time. It is not that much easy to remember everything in my mind and get comfortability immediately. But still, I do accept it is very tough for every beginner, though you have good experience in IT area. But you know, first time we can't get the things in one attempt, right? But in any queries, I'm ready to explain you second time also. Please let me know now itself.
Murali.
Yes.
Can you provide some hands-on after this?
Sure.
So that we can practice.
Sure, definitely. I'll give you some examples. Now, after all these, say for example, while coming object-oriented programming features, I'll demonstrate with some more examples. I'll explain you.
Okay.
Chala. We'll meet after some 5 or 10 minutes break, and we can have that another 1 hour of session. Okay. Thank you. Okay. See, this recorded session will be saved in my local.
Okay, sir.
No, I'm asking you, Raman.
போதும் இல்லைங்க சார், கன்வெர்ட் பண்ணணும். அது நம்ம செஷன் க்ளோஸ் பண்ணும்போது கேட்கும், கன்வர்ஷன் MP4 ஃபார்மட்டுக்கு கேட்கும்.
ஓ ஓகே ஓகே, புரிஞ்சுது.
அதை கன்வெர்ட் பண்ணி நம்ம வச்சுக்கலாம், அதை நம்ம லிங்க் கொடுத்துக்கலாம்.
ஓகே, ஃபுல் செஷனுக்கு வந்து ஒரே வீடியோ தான் வரும்.
ஆமாங்க சார், ஒரு வீடியோ தான் வரும். நீங்க க்ளோஸ் பண்ணீங்கன்னா மட்டும்தான் ரெண்டு வீடியோ வரும். நீங்க பிரேக் பண்ணிட்டு திரும்ப ரீஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணீங்கன்னா ரெண்டு வீடியோ வரும், இல்ல ஒரே வீடியோ தான் வரும்.
Yes, I got it. We'll do it at the end. I'll take your help. Anyway, I'll share my screen, right?
Okay.
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 Good. See, actually now we are accepting the input arguments, right?
Yeah.
So we are accepting input
There's arguments. There's no discussion. Straight catch.
Yes. We'll see how we will accept the input arguments. Okay. So I'll give the message like this. It's not always the values are defined, right? Sometimes user can also give the values at one time.
Sir, when you invoke this get date, it is get striked. What's the reason behind
it? It means it's a deprecated method which is been there in older versions.
Yeah.
But still we are using it.
Okay.
So please enter A value. Now I took the A value. Okay. Now again I'll display. Please enter B value. User will see this message. After seeing this message, what he will do? He will enter B value. So that B value, I should read it into this variable. Which variable? B variable, which is there in object. B is equal to, so you can copy this code again and paste it. Okay. Again, I will read using readLine method, whatever the value we entered, I'll read it, convert into integer, store it into B. Okay. Once I read the A and B value, then I'll call the add method.
Yeah.
So you got it. Now I'll run this program. Java application. See, now it is asking, please enter A value. Okay. Yeah. Now I'll give it as 50. Now it is asking, please enter B value. It is waiting for user to enter the value. I will enter it using br.readline method that will be taken, converted into integer and copied into the object variable. Then I'll call the add method. It will do the perform. I'll give 30. 50 plus 30, 80.
Yeah.
Got it? So in real time, how?
If you doesn't enter any value for B, how much of time that it will wait before throwing that exception?
Not sure about the threshold value, but it will wait for some time and then it will give you what do you say, time bounds exception or something like that. I didn't try it actually, but
okay sir.
Because myself, I have very less patience. Generally, I immediately give the input and then I'll execute the program and keep it.
Okay.
Right. So now it's this how to accept the arguments from the user. Now you are clear with that, right?
Yeah. Yes.
So let's go for object-oriented programming. So what are the object-oriented programming? Guys, like apart from Raman, like other people are there, right? Other four associates. Do you have any questions so far, Ma? You can unmute and then you can reply. Let me hear your voice at least once. Because at the end of the day, to whom you spoke with, okay, I can say only Raman and Murli name. The rest of the three associates, I even didn't heard your name, your voice at all.
Hello, sir. Hello, sir.
Oh, that is why you are unmute, because noise is...
Sorry for the inconvenience, sir. This is Abid Zubair from Infosys.
Yeah, hi, yes.
I just joined here.
Any doubts you have so far, Ma?
No, sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Hello sir, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me? Okay, fine, not a problem. You just reply me in this IM. We have chat window, right?
Yes, sir.
So there you can reply me if you have, if everything is fine, you just say okay, then I'll proceed. I think when you were logging into the session, you didn't enter your name. That's why three associates, your name is not displaying in the go-to meeting. So Jay Ganesh is clear.
It not prompt me to enter my name actually.
Yeah. Jay Ganesh is clear. What about Habib?
Yeah.
Okay, good. And what about the other lady associate? Sorry, it's not Habib, it's Abid. Okay, sorry Abid. Professor Raman voice is now a bit not clear today morning. Now it is bit, I think he had some food. Now his voice is pretty much audible. Good. So what about the lady associate? Is she clear? Gautam here.
Bhagyalakshmi.
Okay, Bhagyalakshmi. Gautam is clear. Abid is also okay. Is clear. And we have Murli as well. Murli, you have any questions? And Bhagyalakshmi, you can reply me in the chat. If you're okay, then I'll proceed to the object-oriented programming features. And we have static and final keyword. Once that is done, yes, we are done with Core Java. We are ready and to proceed with map-reducing coding. Even map-reducing coding is very, very interesting. You'll enjoy the session for sure. Okay.